Hey again, everyone. Do you want to relive the golden age of desktop computing in the palm of your hand? Well, now you can. I realize that's quite the proclamation, but in this video I'm going to show you how you can play Warcraft 2, Diablo, Fallout, Starcraft, and thousands of other MS-DOS and Windows 98 era titles using Retroarch for the iPhone, iPad, and Apple TV. Those mad lads at Apple accepted this onto the App Store, and it can be yours for the low, low price of free. In the past couple videos on the topic, I've mentioned some updates coming in regard to keyboard handling and various core stability issues for Retroarch on iOS. They've been pushed to the App Store version, so if you installed your copy of Retroarch, you'll need to update the app using the App Store to get the latest changes. Most of this video is going to involve keyboard usage, and while Retroarch does have a good on-screen keyboard, I suggest getting a Bluetooth keyboard if you want to use DOS or Windows applications in Retroarch. In regard to keyboards, if you can find one, I highly suggest a Zeg Folio keyboard shell case, which is one of the few cases with a true hinge rather than a prop that sits open. I'm going to be going through a few major topics in this video. Adding a few MS-DOS games to DOSBox-Pure, keyboard and mouse setup and performance tweaks for DOS gaming in DOSBox-Pure, and then I'll be moving on to installing Windows 98 in DOSBox-Pure, and installing and a little bit of demo play of a few games running inside of Windows 98. This isn't a substitute for reading the DOSBox-Pure documentation, however. More of a quick start guide and a summary of my experience trying out a few programs on the new core. For this video, I'm going to assume you're familiar with the basics of navigating and configuring the Retroarch front-end and playlists. If you aren't, I do cover some of that in the past videos linked in the description. Alright, let's get into it. The video clips here are screen recordings done locally on my iPad, so that may slightly reduce performance of the emulator. And this iPad is an older model. You may get better performance on newer iPads. I'll be using a paired Bluetooth keyboard and mouse in this, and all Bluetooth keyboards and mice should be handled the same way by Retroarch once they're paired to your device and active. For the gamepad, I'm using a third-party PS4 controller. The DOSBox-Pure core uses zip files to manage games as if they were individual ROMs. Zip each of your game directories as a separate zip file, and then put them in a main DOS games directory. Transfer that to your device using file management in iTunes, or as a download, and then move it using the Files app. There is a bit of a, I don't know what to call it other than an issue, because it's not really a bug. It's a bit of an issue with file locations and permissions. Retroarch in some cases has trouble accessing files outside the Retroarch folder. In other words, the Retroarch cores can't seem to load data from the directory accessible to the iTunes file manager. The cores can only access data from the Retroarch subfolder of the main Retroarch folder that's accessible to the file manager. I hope that makes sense. And I'll try to demonstrate this once we get there. However, I wanted to say that now because a lot of people dip out of these videos once they get a bit of information that they came for. Once you have some DOS games on your device, navigate to Import Content and then Manual Scan. Make sure Scan Inside Files is not selected and then click Scan to add your games. If your game is named with the game's name and the year of release in brackets, you may be able to automatically grab box art and thumbnails for it. A lot of popular programs already have gamepad keys mapped to keyboard keys and will be playable out of the box, but depending on your setup, you may want to configure the binds to your liking using the controller setup under the quick menu and save a game override. If a game is ready to play, its directory can simply be zipped up and scanned into Retroarch. If it's a game that requires installation, you can simply add the ISO or bin and queue file. Games can also be prepared to have their play files prepackaged alongside the disk image. When the game is launched using the DOSBox-Pure core, you'll be dropped into a launch menu. Here's an example of a game packaged alongside of the disk image. I've already installed this copy of X-Wing. The play files show up as the C drive and the disk image is automatically mounted to the D drive. I'll go ahead and reinstall this and configure the sound settings. Auto detect often works well enough in most games, as long as you don't have both Gravis Ultrasound and Sound Blaster emulation enabled at the same time. I didn't have my gamepad properly configured, so this is just me being completely unable to fly using the keyboard input, but hey, it does run pretty well. And a nice surprise was that Fallout 1 for MS-DOS runs really well in DOSBox-Pure. but I did tweak a couple options that seemed to make it play a little better. After launching the game, open the quick menu and navigate to core options. Then scroll to video, and in the video menu, raise the amount of video memory from 2 MB to 4 MB. And you may want to enable aspect ratio correction if the video looks stretched or squashed. Back out of that menu and then scroll to system, and raise the amount of system memory to 32 MB. And make sure that the CPU core is set to normal interpreter. Open the emulation configuration and enable 460 frame per second output. Then restart the game. If you want to play using a gamepad, there is a good pre-configured controller mapping. Open the quick menu, scroll to controls, then go to port 1 controls, and find the custom keyboard and mouse on thumbstick settings at the bottom of the list. Back out of the menu and scroll to manage core options and then save a game options file. You may need to tweak settings to dial in performance for individual games in DOSBox-Pure. The first thing I suggest toggling is trying the other available CPU mode in the core options. Sometimes simple works better than normal, and sometimes normal works better than simple. Save a game override in the quick menu if you want the settings for a game to be saved. Getting non-game applications working on DOSBox-Pure is pretty easy as well. Simply zip up the program along with any required data files, and add it as you would a game. Here I've packed up Cubic Player 1.6, a music tracker, and a bunch of mod files. Setting up DOS games is pretty straightforward, but DOSBox-Pure does have support for Windows 3.1, 95, and 98. It's a little more involved, and there are a few quirks when it's running on an Apple device. Over the past few years, DOSBox-Pure has really simplified the OS installation process. You don't need to make hard disk images on another device anymore, or clumsily swap boot devices. It's all handled internally through the preloader menu. What I'll do over the next few minutes is install Windows 98, tweak a few Windows 98 settings, and install a few drivers and utilities. Then install and take a look at the performance of a few games. For Windows installations, place any ISO files that you want accessible to Windows inside of a subfolder in the main Retroarch folder. That means if you use iTunes to transfer the files, you'll still need to open the Files app, open the Retroarch program folder, then open the second Retroarch folder, make a directory there, and move your ISOs to there. So, the Retroarch program folder, the Retroarch subfolder, and then a Windows 98 folder, for example. After it's installed, DOSBox-Pure handles booting Windows 98 in two different ways. You can have a separate OS for each game, or a single OS that you install multiple games onto and boot like a PC. I'm doing the second way here. I've added the Windows 98 ISO to Retroarch, and I've launched it with the DOSBox-Pure core. And then I've selected the option to install a new OS. I have to keep an eye on the amount of disk space on my iPad because I'm also screen recording here, so I'll do a small 1 GB installation. Once the CD loads, you'll see a boot menu, and then you can select boot from CD-ROM and follow the initial installation instructions. To use the gamepad as a mouse, I had to open the quick menu and then go to controller options and change the device type from pad mapper generic keyboard to one of the custom keyboard and mouse options at the end of the list. Follow through the Windows 98 installation process and customize the installed components if you want to tweak things. I just left things as a default install here. There are a couple of Retroarch options you may want to tweak for Windows 98. These will apply whenever the Windows 98 installed OS is running or the applications are running within it. In the quick menu, open the core options and navigate to system. Raise the system memory to 64 MB. The S3 Trio card should be set to 4 MB, and the Voodoo emulation should be enabled by default. You may find that things work best using the normal core type. Save the game options and then restart the core. Once Windows 98 restarts, you can adjust the display resolution. I find that 800x600 is comfortable, but you may want to go higher, and raise the number of colors to 16 million. Next, I'm going to install the driver for a 3DFX Voodoo emulation. This requires that you somehow get the driver files onto your emulated drive. The easiest way that I've found is to, on my PC, create an ISO of the files that I want to copy over, and then transfer that to my iPad as I would any other game ISO, and then use disk management to mount the created ISO. Once you have the driver available on your device, hit Start, open the control panel, and hit System. Then open the Device Manager. Navigate to the Voodoo device and open Properties. Then select Update Driver. Select Next, then Display a list of all devices. And then select your Voodoo device driver. Then select Display a list of all devices, and under the Voodoo device, select Have Disk. Navigate to the driver file, install it, and then restart the system when prompted. You may also want to install the latest DirectX available for Windows 98. And after a reboot, we have a more or less fully functioning updated copy of Windows 98. You recognize this?
Winamp. It really whips the llama's ass.
Well, how about this? Now I'll go through a couple game installs quickly to show how disk swapping and installing multiple titles on one OS works in DOSBox-Pure. Just place your ISO in a directory below the location of the Windows 98 ISO or alongside it. Open the quick menu and then navigate to Disk Control. Load the ISO into the loader queue with Load Disk. Select the current disk index and then select your game disk. Then hit Insert Disk to load the disk image into the virtual drive. Close the quick menu and the disk should appear in Drive E. There's no real need to do a large install because running from the ISO seems to be as fast as running the installed game. The load times are on par with playing it on a PC from that era. Starcraft is a little more demanding on the system, and it did struggle a bit when playing the cinematics, but the gameplay was reasonable and the sound wasn't too choppy. Similarly, Diablo was a little crunchy when playing the intro, but the actual gameplay was pretty smooth.
And a fellow drinking peace?
That's about all I want to go over in this one. Sort of a quick start guide to getting things up and running with the DOSBox-Pure core for Retroarch on iOS. If you found this video helpful, please hit the like button or leave a comment. It doesn't even have to be anything important. It can even just be sharing where you're watching from. Not only does it make me feel less insane as I talk to the computer monitor, it helps the channel tremendously. A few comments is all it took to get the last video that I posted, the one about resurfacing CDs and DVDs by hand, to get out to more than 1,000 viewers in less than a week. And I know that practically by YouTube standards that's nothing, but that's really big for this channel. So thank you to everyone that helped make that happen. I'll be back soon with another one of whatever this is I do here. Thanks for watching.